I promise watching this lesson 3 of my free photography course, you will boost your understanding of shutter speed. And at the end, I will even give you my popular cheat sheet and tell you how you can learn photography while doing your daily business on the loop. But to start, we first need a short recap of lesson 1. The light in our scene has passed the aperture, but our sensor is not yet exposed to that light because it is blocked by a shutter curtain. The image taking process will not start before we hit the shutter button of our camera. Once we do that, the shutter curtain will be lifted to expose the sensor to the light, and after a set period of time, the shutter will close again and end exposure. And now to the term shutter speed. The speed at which the shutter opens and closes is always the same, no matter what shutter speed you choose. What does change is the time it stays open. That can be a tiny fraction of a second, several minutes, or even hours for specific uses. So it is all about the time the shutter stays open. If the speed doesn't change, why would you call that shutter speed? I have no idea who started this nonsense, but the correct term that will finally make you understand that camera setting is exposure time. So far so good, but why would a longer exposure time create a brighter image? That's actually rather easy to understand. Light basically consists of light particles. Any scene sends out light and therefore sends out light particles towards your camera. If a scene is brighter, it will send out more light particles. All your sensor does, again, basically, is to collect these light particles. Now imagine that we're giving the sensor more time to collect the light particles by increasing the exposure time. Giving it more time to collect also means the sensor collects more light particles, so logically the image will again become brighter. If you need a memory aid, compare the light particles to snowflakes. Here I have a very simple representation of a camera sensor. If I expose the sensor to the snowfall for a very short time, the sensor will only collect a few snowflakes, and it won't be all that bright. If I, however, expose the sensor to the snowfall for a much longer time, it will collect a lot more snowflakes and become brighter. So what determines image brightness is first the amount of light, and second, for how long that amount can impact the sensor. The amount of light is determined by the brightness of our scene. But not only that, we already know that depending on our settings, the aperture may block some of the light too. And the duration the sensor is exposed to that light is determined by the exposure time. Or, as we photographers usually call it, shutter speed. Now imagine, as you have learned in lesson 2, you want an image with a bigger depth of focus. That would require you to choose a higher aperture number. Let's say that would block half of the light. That would reduce the light particles the sensor can count by 50%. So you have to pay a price for that bigger depth of focus. You get a darker image. The good news is we can compensate for the loss of 50% of those light particles by doubling the exposure time. That would still give you the same image brightness we started with. But since you chose a bigger F number, you'll get an image with a bigger depth of focus. Cool, right? But it gets even better. Before we get to that, let's take a short break and let me give you a tip. If anything I say in this photography course is too fast for you to grasp, you can of course repeat it, which I would highly recommend. Maybe try it right away. Set the speed to 75%, go back to this point in the video and repeat it. The last 2 minutes are incredibly important for your understanding of photography. I promise, repeating is worth it. The key is that you have to realize that this camera setting is about a time frame. It is impossible to understand if you think of that setting as shutter speed. However, I will not be fighting windmills, so going forward, I will call it shutter speed and sometimes remind you that the correct term is exposure time. Now to the even cooler part. Just like with aperture, you can use varying shutter speeds to create a much more exciting and creative effect. Shutter speed determines whether a moving subject in your frame will create a sharp or a blurred image. And of course, I want you to understand why. Here we have a car with headlights. If it stands still during exposure, you will get a rather sharp image of the car and the headlights. No matter how long our exposure time is, the car will stay there. But what if it moves while we take the image? The car will move across the frame and we get light trails. Why is that? The lens projects the scene onto the sensor, and during our long exposure time, the car will not always be at the same spot on the sensor. Instead, it will move across the frame and expose the sensor first here, then there, and so on. In the end, we don't get the sharp image of the headlights, but in this case, a pretty cool shot with light trails. Unfortunately, for other subjects, the blur that is created by your subject moving is annoying. Let's shoot some images of me walking. If I use a long exposure time, I will also move across the frame while the shutter is open. Therefore, we don't get a sharp image, but rather what I'd call a motion path. You might call it a blurry mass. That is not what we want, so let's choose a shorter exposure time. Photographers would say a faster shutter speed.
We started with 1/8 of a second, let's now use 1/15 of a second. That is roughly half the exposure time. Keep in mind we are talking about fractions, so 1/8 of a second is longer than 1/15 of a second.
What do we get? Well, there's two things we see. First, the image isn't as blurry as before. In fact, the motion blur is cut in half. But we also see that the image is a lot darker than before. Of course it is darker, because if the sensor only has half the time, it can only get the half the light particles. What can we do? You know that already. We compensate for the loss of light by telling the aperture to block less light. To be exact, we tell it to only block half as much light as before.
I hope you see the pattern. We get half the light when we choose a faster shutter speed, and we get that half back when we tell the aperture to only block half as much light.
Another try and you see the image brightness is now the same as in our original shot, but I'm still way too blurry. So we need to choose an even shorter exposure time.
Halving the exposure time again and trying 1/30 of a second will still give us a way too blurry image. So let's shorten the time a lot and go to 1/250 of a second. To go from 1/30 of a second to 1/250 of a second, I need to rotate the shutter speed dial by 9 clicks. And the cool thing is, to compensate with aperture, I just need to rotate the aperture dial by the same amount of clicks, only in the opposite direction.
Another try and we see the image is much sharper. Actually, it is almost sharp.
And it still has the same image brightness that we started with when we used 1/8 of a second.
So in regard to image brightness, aperture and shutter speed are interchangeable. What we see additionally, by opening the aperture to compensate for the loss of light due to the much faster shutter speed, the depth of focus is already much shallower compared to our first image. Okay, but what if I don't walk through the frame, but rather run? I've put on super fast clothes for that. I hope you appreciate me making a fool out of myself. If you do, don't forget to click the like button. I'll wait for you until you've done that. Ready? Thanks. Okay, what did we get? Leaving the settings exactly as they were when I was walking, I'm suddenly blurred again. Why is that? Well, I moved across the frame much faster than before, and that's why I left a motion path again instead of a sharp image. So we see, the faster your subject moves across the frame, the faster your shutter speed has to be. Well, again, it's actually not a faster shutter speed, but rather a shorter exposure time. But we won't fight windmills. Despite being totally exhausted already, let's do another try with an even faster shutter speed. Let's try 1/1000th of a second. Okay, that's sharp now, but I forgot to compensate for the loss of light by changing the aperture. Well, to be honest, I didn't forget. The problem is the aperture is already set to the lowest f-number that is possible for this lens, so it is wide open. I wonder if you can already guess what we can do to still get an image that is bright enough. But to learn in a structured way, we won't discuss that now. We will talk about it in lesson 4 of this course.
For now, let's say goodbye to the exhausted runner wolf.
In this video, we will continue with a few creative sample shots that are supposed to show you what you can achieve with different shutter speeds. But before we do, I have to mention another source of unwanted motion blur. What if it's not your subject that moves while you take the image, but you shaking the camera? Not deliberately, but because you don't hold it 100% still. In that case, you would also get a blurry image. To avoid that, you can stick to a formula that I also explain in the cheat sheet. Use a shutter speed that is faster than 1 over the focal length you're using. So if you're using a 100mm lens, use a shutter speed faster than 1/100th of a second to avoid motion blur due to you unintentionally shaking the camera while pressing the shutter. That is obviously less of a problem if you use a tripod. Okay, now I will show you some creative sample shots. I have listed the shutter speeds that I used. You've seen the light trades already. There are lots of opportunities for roads, no matter if mountain roads or roads in the city. Just go out and experiment. I promise you will love it. Other popular subjects for long exposure photography are fireworks and of course waterfalls. All these shots are based on the fact that moving subjects create a blur if you use long exposure times. Even star trails are possible if you extend the exposure time long enough. Or getting silky smooth water on the coast despite crashing waves. But of course, more often than blurring, you want to freeze motion. For example, to photograph your kids playing basketball, your running dog, or birds in flight. For people who are subscribed to my email list, The Wolf Letter, I have created a shutter speed cheat sheet. You can print it and hang it on your fridge, on the bathroom door, or maybe put it in your camera bag for reference. Talking about the bathroom and the toilet, studies show that 75% of Americans use their mobile devices on their toilets. That's why the Wolf method that I explained in lesson 2 also contains very short memory aid videos that you can regularly use on the toilet to repeat what you learned. And there is even more! Perhaps the most important part of the Wolf method are the drill trainings that I already explained. The next drill training is the one for shutter speed. It is the perfect tool to outsource tasks to muscle memory. And it is already waiting for you at wolfarmory.com. But now I need to get busy. See you in the next video that will bust a few more things that you thought you knew about photography.